Good evening. I almost said good morning. It's funny how that works. Well, thank you so much for coming out tonight. Christmas Eve, Christmas, for some reason I thought it would be more hectic with it being on the actual holiday, Sunday being on the holiday, but for whatever reason, this has been one of the most relaxing Christmas weeks I've ever had, so it's wonderful how God works like that. Well, whether you're here with us tonight, if you don't have anywhere to go tomorrow, that's all I'm going to say. We'd love to have you on Sunday, Christmas Day, tomorrow morning at 10. I'm going to read a call to worship, and then we're going to sing. From Isaiah chapter 9. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Amen? Let's pray. Gracious Father in heaven, we thank you so much that we get to gather on this beautiful night. Thank you for the snow. Thank you for all the things that we might have grumbled about before, but thank you for the beauty that you give us in creation. And Lord, we just ask that from beginning to end, you fill our service with the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit, so that we may give you the blessing and the glory and the honor that you, God, so richly deserve. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Would you all stand with us, please?
Shall come to thee, O Israel. Fitting that I follow a song by Gloria. We're going to do a responsive reading of the Christmas story, and I'll read part, and you can read part, and then we'll read all parts of it together. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered.
And all that is to be registered, each to his own town.
And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David.
To be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was a child.
And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth.
And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn.
And in the same region there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flocks at night.
And the angel of the Lord appeared to
And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger."
And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying,
"Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child.
And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them.
But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. You can be seated.
Savior of the world, he
be seated. Well, this is a special season, and such, we're having a special service. But in these special seasons, we'll make sure that we are reminded of the right things. I don't know about you, but sometimes when I get busy, I lose my focus, and I need to be recentered and reoriented around the right things. So this special time, we want to also partake in the Lord's Supper. We pause right now because we are remembered and reminded of Christ's birth. But those of us that are Christians in here, we don't look at the birth of Christ as an isolated event. We look at that as just a part of the picture of the whole true gospel. The whole true gospel is that Christ came as a baby, he lived a perfect life, and he went to the cross and died for our sins. And so we're going to partake in the Lord's Supper in just a minute. And I want to invite you, if you are a Christian here, to take it. We do have open communion. So if you've repented of your sins and you've trusted in Christ as your Savior, then we invite you to take the Lord's Supper with us. I'm going to invite the men to come forward at this time. But before Jesus came to this earth as a baby, there were many promises from God about who he was and the Messiah that he was going to be. He was told that he was going to be a better prophet than Moses. We are told that he was going to be a pure and mighty king, more pure than David. But there was also another prophecy that came through the prophet Isaiah. He prophesied that the Messiah was going to be a servant. And he was also going to be a servant that suffered. Listen to me as I read Isaiah 53, verses 3 through 7. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted. Yet he opened not his mouth like a lamb that is led to the slaughter. And like a sheep that there before its shears are silent. So he opened not his mouth. We remember this season, remember today, that this baby that we remember so much at Christmas time, this baby grew up, he lived a perfect life. And even though he lived a perfect life, he was still ridiculed, he was still mocked, he still suffered. And all that suffering was on our behalf. Just like the prophet Isaiah said, Christ suffered and he bore all of our transgressions. All of us that have sinned, all of us that have placed our faith in Christ, he bore every single one of our sins. And so we celebrate that, we recognize that in the partaking of the Lord's Supper. We see the bread and the juice, and we remember the cross. The cross is a terrible yet beautiful thing. It's beautiful because those of us that have sinned, we see the cross and we see our sins nailed to that cross. We need to see the cross. We need to see it as a beautiful thing because without the cross, there is no peace for us. There is no hope for us. So I hope you are reminded of this at this season. I hope you are thinking about peace and hope and love. And I hope when you think about those things, you see Jesus. And I want to invite you today, if you are questioning those things, if you're struggling with those things, that offer is available to you. Jesus is the Savior of the world, and he is for anybody who calls on his name. Let's pray. Father, we're just so thankful at this time. We come here, we gather. Lord, we're thankful that you sent Christ to take our sins to the cross, Lord. He paid the debt that we deserve, and in return, he gave us his life, his perfect, pure, spotless life he has given to us. And Lord, because of that, you have counted us as righteousness. Lord, help us to remind of that today. Help us see the life that Christ lived and see it as a model. Help us to leave this place and want to be more of a servant like Christ was. Help us want to be more righteous like Christ is. Help us want to tell others about the beautiful gospel that you've given to all of us. Lord, we just thank you for all the things you've given us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Thank you. Behold what light has come, and the dark cannot contain it. The Savior of the world is finally here. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Come, let us adore Him, for He alone is worthy.
First, the bread. First Corinthians 11:24 says, "And as they were eating, Jesus took the bread and blessed it and broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, 'Take and eat, this is my body.'" First Corinthians 11:25 says, "In the same manner, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, 'Drink all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins.'" Would you join me in closing out with the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Adam. Thank you, team. One of my favorite John Newton quotes is this, two things I know, two things I'm certain of. I am a great sinner, and Christ is a great Savior. Amen? You pray with me. Lord God, again, we thank you so much that we get to gather tonight. Lord, what a blessing it is to get to gather on what a beautiful night like tonight. And God, we just pray that we hear from you, that you open our hearts, you open our minds, and pierce your truth down into our spirits. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, church and guests, tonight I want to continue with our second to last message in our sermon series. We've entitled Coming to Bethlehem. If you want to hear the last one, you got to come tomorrow. We've been following along in our Advent season with these weekly themes standing on the platform behind me: hope, love, joy, and peace. Advent comes from the Latin word adventus, and it means coming or arrival. So we celebrate two glorious truths in the Advent season. One we focus on a little bit more as we get closer to Christmas. Technically, today is the last day of Advent. So, number one, Christ came to be born of a virgin in the little town of Bethlehem. And number two, Jesus will come again to judge the living and the dead. So this season has been a time of waiting, preparing, and anticipating the coming of the Lord. Jesus came to us in this first Advent in a manger. Jesus will come back to us in the second Advent as a conquering king. When the glorious day comes, there will be no more sickness, sorrow, pain, or death. Every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord of all. Advent is a very hopeful season. I hope that you've been encouraged. It's all about the coming of the Lord. That first song is the quintessential Advent song, O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel. Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Emmanuel has come to be with us. So the sermon title for this evening is The Greater Bread in Bethlehem. There is significance with Jesus' birth in the town of Bethlehem, and we just sang about this a little bit ago. O little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie. Above thy deep and dreamless sleep, the silent stars go by. Yet in thy dark streets shineth the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. I want to read to you two passages back to back. One of them we've already read a little bit of in Luke chapter 2. And then the other one, John 6. But I wanted to do this because I want to see the connection here with the Christmas season. So Luke chapter 2. Pastor Lon read some of this earlier. And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." And then John chapter 6, starting at verse 32, Jesus talking to the crowds and the disciples. "Truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst." It's the word of the Lord. So let's talk about what the Bible means by bread. Bread is the staple food item, right? A lot of you probably like bread. I like bread. I like bread a little bit too much. But the point is, when the Bible talks about bread, and you can see this in our expressions, when we say we're breaking bread together, are we eating just bread? No, we're dining together. Acts 2:42, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, and the early church devoted themselves to the breaking of bread and prayers. This I am statement, I am the bread of life, is one of seven that Jesus makes in the Bible. Yahweh, the name for God, which means, Yahweh means existing one. God refers to himself to Moses as I am that I am. Jesus used that phrase of himself, I am. And he did it seven times. I am the door. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the good shepherd. I am the true vine. I am the resurrection and the life. And what are we looking at today here? But I am the bread of life. So what is Jesus calling himself? So often when we talk about bread in the Bible, it should bring to mind our need for food. We need to eat. Somebody's like, amen, I need to eat. You know, we get that in America. We get that. Food is essential for life. You can't live without it. You may be able to go a long time without it, but eventually you're going to need to eat. And those of you who have fasted know what it's like to long for food. Those of you who have had to go without during hard times or meager circumstances know what it's like to go without food. So there's a desire to eat, and we need food to be sustained, to be satisfied. Your body will begin to let you know if you don't. So what about God? Does God need things to sustain him? That's the question. So you think of all these folks nowadays, you know, picture the farm, picture the prairie. I'm a self-sufficient person, right? I got this taken care of. I don't ask nobody for nothing if I can't get it on my own. Being self-sufficient only goes so far. There are those who are better at taking care of themselves or living off the land. Some people are better, more skilled with their hands than others. But where did we get the land? And where did we get the animals? Or where did we get the means of acquiring the land or the livestock? Nature. Nature. So we are designed and placed here. We are reliant on the world that we live in. It's set up in a way to where life can be sustained, and you and I didn't have anything to do with that. Farmers need decent weather to produce a crop. Ranchers need a harvest to feed their livestock. We need a healthy environment to be sustained. Tonight's weather, if it was always that way around here, we wouldn't have any food. It'd be like Narnia, it's always winter and never Christmas. But does God need anything like this? Does he need anything? No. He is, in the truest sense, self-sufficient. He doesn't need anything at all. He's the giver of all and all things good, and he's the author of life. When Jesus said, I am the bread of life, he's telling us that he has all that you and I need to be sustained, to be satisfied. We need food, we need water, we need shelter to survive. So again, think about that feeling, how bad you want to eat. You got the hunger pains, you haven't eaten in a long time. Maybe you deal with blood sugar issues, and it drops, and you're like, man, I got to eat something. You don't eat, you start to feel sick. And so here's the deal. By nature, we feed ourselves, right? You're going to do it. You're going to get that impulse, you're going to do it. Water is even more necessary. You can go about we can go only so long without a drink before the desire of water is overwhelming. You can make it 4 days tops without water. That's tops. Some people only make it two or three. If you haven't before you came to this service at this point, you might be thinking about food if you haven't eaten. I wonder why. It's natural, but is life only about a good meal and comfort? That's the question. And Jesus put it this way, is life more than food or the body more than clothing? Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, and they shall be satisfied. So, dear friends, here comes the challenge, and I know it's Christmas Eve. But here's the question. We feed our bodies. Do we feed our spirits? We feed the body. Do we pay attention to the spirit? How much attention do you give concerning spiritual matters? Can you tell when your soul is starving? Is your attitude different? Do you desire God? Is Jesus satisfying? More on that in a moment. What's this got to do with Christmas? 400 years of silence. 400 years, not a word from God, from a prophet. Some shepherds were out with their flocks in the fields, this little town of Bethlehem, just like what seemed like a normal night. Shepherds, by the way, were not the wealthiest folk of society. As far as the standards at that time, they were ranked just above a slave. Servants, common folk, worked in the field. Both Moses and David were shepherds. Normal, what they thought was going to be a normal night, was interrupted by a sky filled with angels, filled with the heavenly host. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. God's messengers had great news to pass on. Now, what's interesting about this is how this king's advent takes place. This is the king of all, right? This message, this arrival, it's passed from angels to men. That part makes sense, but the news from heaven didn't come to the temple. It didn't come to the chief priests. It didn't come to the kings or the elites. It didn't come to all the king's horses and all the king's men. Didn't show up to see Jesus born. Came to shepherds in fields near a quiet town. Christ wasn't born in the throne room of Caesar Augustus or in any great empire. That tells us that he's the Savior for everybody. He's a common man's Savior. He's for people of every tribe, tongue, nation, and status. And what was this message that the shepherds were given? And this wording is important, okay? And the angel said to them, "Fear not." And by the way, angels got to say that because apparently they're pretty intimidating and scary. When they show up, they say, "Don't be afraid. It's going to be all right. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord." To you in the city of David, you are receiving a Savior. That is specific language. So when a child is born, we talk about them as being born to their parents. Did you hear about so-and-so's baby? She's going to be a mom. He's going to be a dad. They're going to have a girl. They're going to have a boy. But the angels didn't say, "Hey, Mary's going to have a son." The angels said, "Unto you a child is born." Jesus was special to Mary and Joseph, but this is good news because he's not just their child. He's born for all of us, and he's the means by which any person, Jew or Gentile, can become a child of God. We're only saved through Jesus. This is good news of great joy for all people. And he came to be born in the same city that the greatest king Israel had ever had was born in. Bethlehem and Jerusalem, by the way, don't get confused by this. Bethlehem and Jerusalem are both referred to in the Bible as the city of David. Jesus and David were both born in Bethlehem. They both died in Jerusalem. Jesus is the descendant of David, the bright and morning star. And this will be a sign for you, the Bible continues. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. Why is the Savior of the world born into such humble circumstances? Why not at the end? Well, due to the census put out by Caesar Augustus, they had to travel to Bethlehem. Joseph had to get registered. But Joseph and Mary couldn't get their own room, and truthfully, because we think inn, we think like Holiday Inn or whatever. Truthfully, this probably wasn't an inn at all in the way you and I would think of them, but probably a residential home with a few guest rooms. Mary gives birth to the Lord Jesus and lays him not in a crib, but what she had available. And what did she have? A manger. A manger. This is incredible, okay? The God through whom the world was made lay sleeping in a feeding trough for animals. And so away the shepherds go to see this child. You're all here, so the weather didn't stop you from coming tonight. And I imagine if a host of heaven's angels showed up and told you to come and see this, that you would move heaven and earth to go and see what they were talking about. Come and see these tidings of comfort and joy. So the birth of Jesus, in this manner, of course, these humble circumstances, it's not an accident. It's providence. It's providence. So what do these two passages, what do they have to do with each other? The bread of life, Jesus born in a manger. Jesus' name means the Lord is my salvation. God saves. Yeshua saves, if you want to say it in more Jewish tone. Bethlehem. Do you know what Bethlehem means? House of bread. Bethlehem was generally a fruitful little town, producing abundant wheat, barley, olives, almonds, and grapes. And we studied this back in the book of Ruth. Bethlehem, who was usually very fruitful, had a famine, which wasn't a coincidence, because that led to Ruth the Moabite coming from Moab into the faith, into Bethlehem, which led to David being born in Bethlehem. Jesus was born in Bethlehem. And so we could say it this way. The God who saves, the Lord is my salvation, the one who puts himself on par with I am that I am, who calls himself the bread of life, was born in a feeding trough in a place called the house of bread. That is incredible. Moses and the Israelites, what did they feed on when they wandered through the desert? Manna, bread that fell from heaven. And we are sustained by the bread of life, who also came down from heaven. We celebrated the body and the blood of our Lord earlier. And the law of God states, and Jesus quoted to Satan, what? Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. And so what the Bible is telling us, what Jesus is telling us there, is that we need a different kind of food. We need a different kind of food. There's natural food, and then there's soul food, you know? But it's not like what we think about. We need spiritual food. It means we need a healthy diet of gathering and partaking in the Spirit of God. So we come back to that application idea, and I just have to ask, how much do you desire heavenly things? How much do you desire Jesus? We hunger and we thirst for natural things. Do we hunger for the spiritual? Do we hunger and thirst for righteousness, the things that are good? Do we feed the flesh but starve the spirit? What a great gift we have received to celebrate in the Christmas season. We can feed our spirits by communing with God, reading the scriptures, gathering together in prayer. You can always approach God with your prayers. These graces are different, though. They're not natural. You don't get, your body won't start shutting down like it would if you didn't drink water, if you don't pray visibly. But you will feel it because we have a spirit. They're not natural, but they are essential. And though we have a hard time believing it in the way that we live, myself included, the soul is of infinite more importance than this body. And so the wait is almost over. Advent is almost over this time. And just like a child who eagerly waits to unwrap presents on Christmas morning, some of y'all are thinking about that right now. Some of the grown-ups are thinking about that. Come on, you know you are. I hope that more than that, we long for the Lord Himself and for the second coming when He comes to set everything right. So all of us have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God. But there is forgiveness with Jesus. And I have to say, there are no spiritual elites. No spiritual elites. The ground is level at the foot of the cross. I'm just a beggar telling other beggars where to find bread. And bread came to us. And the bread, the sustainer of life, showed up in a feeding trough. Now, friend, I don't know where you're at spiritually, but you got to come to Jesus as you are. You can't wait until you get cleaned up. It's like that hymn that we sang earlier. Come to Bethlehem. Come and see Him whose birth the angels sing. Come, adore on bended knee, Christ the Lord, the newborn King. Worship team, go ahead and come up. Deacons, go ahead and come up too. I ask you, friend, what is your life? Jesus taught His disciples, and He teaches us, this is from John chapter 6, verse 27, says this, "Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you, for on Him God the Father has set His seal." And so I want to encourage you this evening, enjoy the grace of life. Enjoy those graces. Enjoy these holy days. Do not take that hands off. Do not taste. Do not handle. Do not touch approach. That is a very bad way to live the Christian life. Feast. Be merry. But don't neglect to feed your spirit. Feed your body and your spirit by feasting on the bread of life who's been given to us in a manger. And though He came in a manger, He's going to come back in glorious robes of white. And so we say, as the church has said for years, Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Amen? Let's pray. Lord God, we thank You so much. Lord, give us a desire that goes beyond this present existence. Help us to desire the One who is seated at the right hand of God the Father. At Your right hand is fullness of joy and pleasures forevermore. The promise that it gets better. Hope for today. Joy for today. Peace on earth. Goodwill toward men. Thank You, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Would you all stand, and we're going to sing Silent Night, and we'll pass the light as we do.
I hesitate, I will say Merry Christmas Eve. But if you don't have a place to go tomorrow, we'd love to see you here again. Because what better day to celebrate the birth of our Lord than on the Lord's Day? So may the Lord bless you. May he keep you. Make his face to shine upon you. Go in peace in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Merry Christmas Eve. Amen.